Welcome to our campout here at Norris Lake this weekend. Good to have you with us this morning. We have a lovely tent that's been set up for us. Thank you to Mark Green for taking the responsibility to get this set up for us. And we have a baptism plan today and a great service, time of worship and everything. Those of you watching online, this service is being taped and you'll be watching it later on today or perhaps during the week. Thank you for joining us. We trust you'll enjoy our service here in the great outdoors. We are at Norris Lake, Manitoba. It's about 10 minutes northwest of Teulon along Highway number 17, and we've been having a weekend camping out here since Friday evening. So we are looking forward to a great time of worship and praise together. A couple of announcements, or at least one major announcement. One oversight that we made in preparations, we didn't provide, we should have, for a porta potty. So the camp here has washrooms, but they're down the road a bit. If you drove in, you probably saw them on, I don't know, your left or your right. It's on the left hand side. So you might have a little bit of a hike. Otherwise, we're apologizing for that. We thought of that yesterday, that we should have gotten in. But anyways, that's just a bit of information. All right, I think that's all the announcements for now. We will have more a little later on. As we begin, let's bow in prayer and ask God's blessing upon our time. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to have this camp out here. Thank you for everyone who showed up here this morning, and we're enjoying the beautiful summer weather that you've given to us. Thank you for the opportunity just to gather as a church family. Thank you for those who come as guests. We appreciate them being along with us as well. We pray that as a result of this service, our faith in Christ will grow and that our relationship with you will become all that you want it to be. I stand against all the forces of darkness, and I claim this territory, this piece of terra firma, for the Lord Jesus Christ, and we proclaim Jesus as Lord over campsite here of Norris Lake, and we believe that this will be a great day for your glory. In Christ's name we pray. And everybody said,
Amen.
All right. Crystal and Bradley are going to come, and Emily, lead us in a time of praise and worship. If you don't have a song sheet, Ian has them. Handing out, so make sure you just lift your hand. Very good.
Raise your hand.
Oh, there's two spots here.
I don't know if you want to stand together or stay seated, but
do whatever you want.
Our son for life flashed before thee.
us to God this morning. Well, this morning we wanted to have an opportunity to share of, we're going to open it up to the you to share any experiences that you had in camping. They can be funny experiences, they can be deeply spiritual experiences, family camping or Bible camps, whatever. So an opportunity just to you to talk about it. So we thought in the camping environment it would be good to give you an opportunity to share like that. So if anybody has a camping story, Crystal Bergeron, you're going to start off.
So when I was younger and Jurassic Park came out, I was petrified of the movie. Petrified. I sat under the seat. So we went camping in Rushing River, and we always brought our screen with us to watch movies outside while we were camping, projector. And my family, my husband, my cousin, and my children thought it would be great if we watched Jurassic Park and it had the noise coming from out the bush. That was not fun.
All right. Anybody else with a camping experience that's interesting to hear that you went through? All right. Ron, and then back there, Sharon afterwards.
I used to take people up north here to a lake north of before Norway House. But anyway, took one of the officers into town. Coming back, we played around the lake with the boat for a while. And then we went to go eat supper. And I had hypothermia. Because I had a t-shirt on, soaking wet.
Oh my goodness.
So that's odd because I was the one that taught hypothermia. So.
Oh.
don't do what I do.
You didn't practice what you preach.
Do what they say, not what they do.
Good. All right, Sharon, what's your story?
Well, we had a truck camper, and Amber was just a baby, like just a few months old, so I didn't want to go too far, but we wanted to go camping. So we went out to the back 40 of our farm. And so everything went really nice. We went to bed, and in the middle of the night, the dogs started running around and around and around the truck, and around and barking like you wouldn't believe. And so Myron opens the door of our camper just to see what was going on, and here there was a skunk with its feet on the bumper ready to hop into the camper.
He did let you know he'd been there.
Yeah.
Oh wow, that's quite the story. Great story. Anyone else with an experience? Yes, Catherine.
So last year I went camping to Montana, and that's when a lady, before I left the one Yellowstone campsite, a lady gave me a note talking to Jesus and how I was a child of God. And that's what led me to becoming a Christian.
Wow.
So that was the camping experience that you had at Yellowstone.
In Montana, yeah.
In Montana there. Wonderful. Praise the Lord. Anyone else with a camping story? Joe.
We were building our house years ago. So we used a 17-foot camper to live in next to the building site. And I had a St. Bernard at the time who was about 240 pounds. And lo and behold, there was a lightning storm.
Oh, boy.
Now, you haven't lived till you're in a 17-foot camper and a 200-some-odd-pound St. Bernard trying to crawl into bed with you petrified of lightning and thunder. Mm-hmm. I'll never forget a big head drooling all over.
Oh, no.
So that was my first time using a camper, really, for that use.
Sharing it with a St. Bernard.
Yeah.
No, those are not small dogs either.
Oh, and he was a big one.
Good. Great stories. Mark?
Well, I always stayed in a tent when we used to camp, and always ended up with that rock or root under the tent. I didn't like that. So we got camp.
And now you have a little bit more comfort. Good. Anyone else? Camping story over the years. All right, Myron.
We were camping at Manhattan Beach, and at the beach, we were probably the only tent there, and it was just pouring rain, and the kids were in the tent with us, and here we woke up, and we had to restake the tent down because it was so windy, and all of a sudden this big branch fell and missed the tent, thank goodness. So we went, and we went to the washroom that night, and in the morning we woke up and the tent was really damp, and they have a little bookstore there, and we were at the bookstore in the morning, and guy that was managing the camp said, you guys are the ones that were in that tent, weren't you? And we said, yeah. He says, come with me. And he took us to the office, and he says to the lady, he says, are there any cabins left? And the lady said, yeah, there's one till Thursday. He says, give it to them. And she says, how much do I charge? And he says, nothing. Just let them keep it safe. So that was really nice.
Oh, very nice.
It rained all week that week. It was one of these seasons that we had earlier. Yeah.
We got in there and we didn't want to leave. Yeah. It was so cozy in that cabin.
Sweet. Very good. As I was driving up this morning, I was thinking about some of my camping experiences. And the first time I went camping was actually Thursday, July the 25th, 1958. I was a 9-year-old boy, and we had a Bible camp just about 4 miles away from where we lived in Saskatchewan at that time. It was my first time away from home, first time camping. And I'll never forget that Thursday morning as the camp counselor, and I never forgot his name, Bill Dick. I've never ever had a chance to, down through the years, I've met him to thank him. But he was our counselor, and he shared the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ with us. And as a 9-year-old boy, and I was thinking about that this morning as I was driving up here, I remember as I was sitting there, the prompting to respond to the invitation to accept Christ as Savior. And I remember, as I thought about it, I decided, yes, today's the day I'm going to ask Jesus into my heart. I've been wrestling with that decision for about 2 years prior to that. Finally, I gave in. I remember saying to my friend Jerry, who was sitting next to me, I said to him, when the camp counselor Bill said, anyone wants to ask Jesus into their hearts, come and see me after the class is over. We had kind of a Bible study class there. And I turned to Jerry and I said, Jerry, let's go and ask Jesus into our hearts. And he said, sure. And so we went, and there was another boy talking to the counselor. And while that boy was talking, the dinner bell went off. And the boy finally left, and the counselor turned to me and said, yes. And I said, Jerry and I want to ask Jesus into our hearts. And I turned and I pointed at Jerry, and when I looked, he was gone. The dinner bell had rung. He'd gone for lunch. And, of course, I was the one initiating the process anyways. And that morning I asked Jesus into my heart, 9-year-old boy. And my life was changed totally because of that. Many, many years ago. This Thursday, so 1958 to this Thursday, how many years is that? Do the math.
Lots.
1958. Did you say 1958? Yeah, 1958. 66
years.
66 years.
That's a lot of generations.
Yeah. 66 years. All right, we're going to receive an offering this morning. Emily has got her baseball cap. We're going to pass it around. If you came prepared to share with an offering, we always take an offering at church. If you aren't ready, that's okay. But we did want to give you that chance to receive the offering. And Emily's got, oh, you got the bag. I thought you were going to use your dad's baseball cap.
Forgot okay. The hat.
There you go. And as the bag comes around, you can just pass it around, Emily. Thank you. I'm going to have Myron Dearden come at this time, and he's going to read our scripture for us, and it's from the book of Jonah. So if you have your Bible, some of you have it on your phone, turn to Jonah chapter 1. Jonah's in the Old Testament, one of the minor prophets, and he's going to read the entire first chapter. So Jonah chapter 1, Myron's going to read. Myron, come here at the podium.
So Jonah flees from the Lord. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God. And they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain went to him and said, "How can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us, and we will not perish." Then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity." They cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. So they asked him, "Tell us, who is responsible for making this trouble for us? What do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you?" He answered, "I am a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the land." This terrified them, and they asked, "What have you done?" They knew he was running away from the Lord, because he had already told them so. The sea was getting rougher and rougher, so they asked him, "What should we do to you to make the sea calm down for us?" "Pick me up and throw me into the sea," he replied, "and it will become calm. I know that it is my fault that this great storm has come upon you." Instead, the men did their best to row back to land, but they could not, for the sea grew even wilder than before. Then they cried to the Lord, "O Lord, please do not let us die for taking this man's life. Do not hold us accountable for the killing of an innocent man, for you, O Lord, have done as you please." Then they took Jonah and threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. But the Lord provided a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was inside the fish 3 days and three nights.
Thank you, Myron, for reading the passage of Scripture. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Good job, man.
Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. One of the best known stories in the entire Bible is the story that we've just heard Myron read, Jonah and the whale. It's for sure it's one of the stories that Sunday school teachers have taught their students, and Christian parents have told bedtime stories with it all down through the years. This past week, I went through my files and I found a poem that someone had written about Jonah, and it goes like this. It's called Jonah and the Whale. Now, listen, my friends, and I'll tell you a tale how old Jonah the prophet got caught by the whale. The whale caught poor Jonah, and bless your dear soul, he not only caught him, but swallowed him whole. A part of this story is awfully sad. It's how a big city went to the bad. When the Lord saw those people with such wicked ways, he said, "I can't stand them more than 40 days. He spoke to old Jonah and said, "Go and cry to those hard-hearted people and tell them that I give them 40 days more to get humbled down, and if they don't do it, I'll tear up their town." Jonah heard the Lord speaking and said, "No, that's against my religion, and I won't go. Those Nineveh people ain't nothing to me, and I'm against foreign missions, you see." He went down to Joppa, and there, in great haste, he boarded a ship for a different place. The Lord looked down on that ship and said, "Old Jonah, he truly is sick in the head." God said the wind blowing with squeals and with squeaks, and the with squeaks and squeals, and the sea got rowdy and kicked up its heels. Old Jonah confessed that it was all for his sin. The crew threw him out, and the whale took him in. On beds of green seaweed, that fish tried to rest. He said, I will sleep while my food I digest. But he got mighty restless and sorely afraid, and he rumbled inside as the old prophet prayed. On the third day, that fish rose up from his bed with stomach torn up and a pain in his head. He said, I must get to the air mighty quick. This filthy backslider is making me sick. He winked his big eyes and wiggled his tail and headed for shore to deliver his mail. M-A-L-E. He stopped near the shore where he looked all around and vomited old Jonah all over the ground. Old Jonah thanked God for his mercy and grace, and turning around to the whale made a face. He said, after 3 days, I guess you have found a good man, old fellow. It is hard to keep down. He stretched himself out with a yawn and a sigh and sat down in the sun for his clothing to dry. He thought how much better his preaching would be, since from Whale Bible College he now had a degree. And though he was nearly 3 days late, he preached from the time he entered the gate till the whole population repented and prayed, and by God's mercy, great mercy, his vengeance was stayed. Now, friends, when you disobey, remember this tale. When you run from God's call, look out for the whale. Mm-hmm. Well, this is a story in the Bible that a lot of people have struggled to accept as really happening. And of course, many have relegated it to the area of myth. Perhaps you heard the little girl was talking to her teacher about whales. And that was the class subject they were studying, whales. And she said to her teacher that she had heard in Sunday school that a man by the name of Jonah had been swallowed by a whale. And the teacher said to the little girl, she said, well, that's physically impossible for a whale to swallow a human, because even though it's a very large mammal, the throat of a whale is too small for a human being to go through it. And the little girl said to the teacher, well, she said, when I get to heaven, I'll ask Jonah. And the teacher said, but what if Jonah went to hell? And the girl replied, well, then you ask him. Well, I personally believe this story to be true. It actually happened, historically reflective of reality. And I'll share why a little later why I think that. But before we look at the story and the lessons it has for us, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to have this camp out. Thank you for the opportunity to have a service here in the great outdoors. Thank you for the privilege of having the Word of God that we can look at, and the lessons we can draw from the lives of people like Jonah, a runaway prophet, and yet there's amazing lessons to learn from his life. And this morning I pray you'll open our hearts to receive these. They're standing once again against the forces of darkness, command them to go, and I claim the Holy Spirit's presence here, and ask that you will reveal the truth to each of us that needs to be understood as we look at this story. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. The book of Jonah begins with God calling Jonah to go and preach in Nineveh. And verse 1, the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up against me. Now, Jonah was an Israelite, and he was being asked by God to go to the city of Nineveh. City of Nineveh was the capital of the nation of Assyria, also known, the people were called Assyrians. And they were a foreign people group. And God asked Jonah to go preach and tell them to repent. That was the message he was to give to them. Actually, when you think about it, this was the first illustration in the Bible of a foreign missionary crossing one culture, going to another, to share the truth about what God has shared. It would have been quite a trek for Jonah. Nineveh was about 500 miles or 800 kilometers east of his hometown of Gath Hefer in northern Israel. They've actually found the ruins of the ancient city of Nineveh. It's in Iraq today, in the city of Mosul, M-O-S-U-L. And they've actually found the ruins of that ancient city of Nineveh. But as the story tells us, Jonah does not respond as God asks him to. And instead of going to what God asked him to do, he ran away from God and God's call on his life. And notice how it puts it on, it says in verse 3. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. And after paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. And so Jonah's here makes a strategic decision. Instead of going east, he decides to go west. And that's the journey he embarks on. He heads for Tarshish. Tarshish, relationship to Israel, is today in modern Spain, at the far end of the Mediterranean. And so it was about, in that day, as opposite a direction as you could go. The distance from Spain to Israel, 2,200 miles, or about 3,500 kilometers. And it's in the opposite direction of Nineveh. Actually, the distance from Spain to Iraq, and you could drive that today if you go around the all through the European southern part of Europe, is 4,250 kilometers, or 2,640 miles if you fly. And it is a total driving distance of 3,625 miles, or 5,800 kilometers. So obviously the question is why? Why did Jonah run away from going to where God asked him to Nineveh? Well, Jonah lived around about the time of a king in Israel called Jeroboam II, King Jeroboam II, who reigned from the year 786 to 746 BC. And during the reign of King Jeroboam and in that whole era, the Assyrians were the dominant world power. They would be kind of like the United States of America is today, with the dominant world power. And as such, the Assyrians posed a great threat to the national security of Israel. It's like Russia today is a threat to Ukraine. Same kind of scenario. Now we know that from historical records that the Assyrians were amongst the most brutal of people to have ever lived on the face of the earth. We thought the Romans were bad.
No.
You should have heard about the Assyrians. Let me read you what one Assyrian king, Ashurbanipal, proudly records that he did to a people in the city that he captured. I'm quoting Ashurbanipal. I flayed as many nobles as had rebelled against me and draped their skins over the pile of corpses. Some I spread out within the pile, some I erected on stakes upon the pile. In another case, he writes this. I felled 50 of their fighting men with a sword, burnt 200 captives from them, and defeated in a battle on the plain 332 troops. And with their blood, I dyed the mountains red like wool, and the rest of them, the ravines and the torrents of the mountains, swallowed. I carried off the captives and possessions from them. I cut off the heads of their fighters and built therewith a tower before their city. He made a tower out of their skulls. I burnt their adolescent boys and girls. Another description of a different conquest is even worse. In conflict and strife, I besieged and conquered the city. I felled 3,000 of their fighting men with a sword. I captured many troops alive. I cut off some of their arms and hands. I cut off others, their noses, ears, and extremities. I gouged out the eyes of many troops. I made one pile of the living and one pile of heads. I hung their heads on trees around the city. And so Jonah didn't want to have anything to do with saving a people group like that. He thought the best thing for them would be for the justice of God to come down upon them and the Assyrians be wiped out, because God had said, unless they repent, I will destroy them. And so that was Jonah's thinking. And so he thought, I won't go there. And what will happen? The Ninevites will carry on in their wickedness. And God will punish them by wiping them off the map. And then Israel will not have to worry about them anymore. It's kind of like God telling today Benjamin Netanyahu, the Prime Minister of Israel, to go to Iran. And in so doing, tell them to repent, or else God's going to destroy Iran. You can imagine Benjamin Netanyahu would rather see the Iranians die. That sort of scenario today. If there anything, Jonah was a patriot par excellence. That's what you really have. And he wanted what he thought was best for his people, the Israelites. And he was doing this to protect them. And so he ran from Gath Hefer, which was in northern Israel, to the harbor in Joppa, which is by modern-day Tel Aviv. He boarded a ship bound for the city of Tarshish on the western end of the Mediterranean. And we call Jonah the runaway prophet. However, God had other plans for Jonah. And halfway to Tarshish, God sent a huge storm on the Mediterranean. Verse 4, then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. And of course, this then sends the crew into a tizzy while Jonah is down below deck, sound asleep. It says, and all the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God, and they threw out the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone down below the deck where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. Well, the sailors then cast lots to see who's the culprit who's causing this storm to happen. And in the middle of that process, the lot falls on Jonah. We read this verse 7. The sailors said to each other, come, let's cast lots to find out who's responsible for the calamity. They cast lots, and the lot fell on them. And so they go to Jonah and tell him to fess up. And they asked him, tell us, who is responsible for this, making all this trouble for us? What did you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you? And then Jonah goes on and tells his, identifies himself. I am a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and dry land. And this terrified them, because they'd asked, what have you done? And they knew he was running away from the Lord, because they told him so. And so then the sailors say, what are we going to do? And Jonah offers a solution. They said, what shall we do to make the sea calm for us? And he says, pick me up and throw me into the sea. He replied, and it will become calm. I know it is my fault that this great storm has come upon you. And so Jonah says, throw me overboard. He would rather die than admit his wrong and go to Nineveh. That's what committed he was to his plan. And after another futile attempt to get back to land, the sailors do just that. Instead, the men did their best to row back to land, but they could not, for the sea grew wilder, even wilder than before. And they cried out to the Lord, O Lord, please do not let us die for taking this man's life. Do not hold us accountable for killing an innocent man. For you, O Lord, have done as you pleased. And they took Jonah and threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. And at this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. And Jonah is in the sea. But God wasn't finished with Jonah. He prepared, it says, a fish. But the Lord provided a great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was inside the fish 3 days and three nights. Earlier on, I'd mentioned how that many people argue a whale couldn't have swallowed Jonah, as the throat of a whale is too small. I want you to notice, the Bible never says that it was a whale. It says it prepared a great fish. So whoever came up with the idea of whale, it's not in the Bible. It's somebody's imagination that brought it forward. And it was one that God had provided. And so when God provides fish, he provides fish with throats big enough to swallow human beings. All right? And he would have made sure that throat was big enough. I find one thing ironic. You realize that Jonah had to pay for his trip on the boat out, but he got a free ride back. Didn't cost him a penny. And he was inside that fish 3 days and three nights, kept alive supernaturally by God. Earlier on, I talked about that teacher who made fun of Jonah. And I said, a lot of scholars today, if you read anything, go on the internet, Google Jonah, you'll have a lot of people who say, oh, this fable, myth, it's not a true reality, it didn't happen. And that very common perspective that's made. But I want to suggest to you there's one very qualified theologian who said it was true. And do you know who that qualified theologian is?
Jesus
Christ. Amen. Jesus said, as Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights, so the Son of Man will be in the heart of the earth 3 days and three nights. If Jesus said Jonah existed, I'm going with Jesus.
Amen.
Okay. I don't care what the scholars say. I see him as the final great authority.
Amen.
Two lessons from the life of Jonah, and I wrap it up. And the first one is this. I think Jonah's life shows us one thing. You cannot successfully run away from God. Doesn't work. Never succeed. You're running away from God, you're doomed for failure. It won't work. Fruitless endeavor. He'll catch you. Francis Thompson in 1890 wrote a poem called The Hound of Heaven. I love it the way he puts it. And he puts it of his experience. I fled him, talking about God, down the nights and down the days. I fled him down the arches of the years. I fled him down the labyrinthine ways of my own mind. And in the midst of tears, I hid from him. And under running laughter from those strong feet that followed after. But unhurried.